Hey folks, this is Shock, and we're doing these Bible studies, and we did all of Mark, and now we're going to do all of John. Now, don't confuse John with also 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. So we're going to do John, and then we'll do the other ones later also. So let's go to John, and before we do, I want to show you something that you guys can get for free. It's excellent. I would say it's one of the best free gifts that I've ever received, and it's a free audio Bible. So let me show you how you get it. All right, what you do is when you go to shockonow.net right here, I don't know if you see that at the top, shockonow.net, or just click below this video in the description box, and then click where it says free audio Bible right here and watch what happens. When you click it, you could download it or stream it live, and it's excellent. It's not just the New Testament, it's all the Old Testament also. So look, all the way through the New Testament it goes, all the way down to even Revelation. So it's epic. So don't forget to click below this video, go to shockonow.net. And don't forget to click where it says entire Bible on audio. Okay, so let's begin. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. So you know, they're referring to Jesus Christ right there. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, that was he whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have all we received in grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. And this is the record of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who art thou? And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, what then? Art thou Elijah? And he saith, I am not. Art thou that prophet? And he answered, no. Then they said unto him, who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? So what you see here is the leaders of the Jewish temple. Notice it says the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask John who he is, right? So they go ask John, and John says, I'm not the Messiah, I'm not Elijah. And they say, well, what should we tell those who sent us who you are? So check out what John says. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord, as he said the prophet Isaiah. And they which were sent were of the Pharisees. And they asked him and said unto him, why baptizest thou then, if thou be not the Christ, nor Elijah, neither that prophet? They're like, well, why are you baptizing then? John answered them, saying, I baptize with water, But there standeth one among you whom you know not. He it is who, coming after me, is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unloose. So he refers to Jesus Christ as Jesus Christ being so awesome that John's saying, I'm not even worthy to untie his shoes, his sandals. So John's explaining that right there. So let's talk again. These things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and saith, Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, After me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, Upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is which he baptized with the Holy Ghost. So John's saying that he had as a sign that when he sees the Spirit descending upon this person, notice that person, the same as which he baptized with the Holy Ghost. And he says, and I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. So he does see the Spirit descending upon Jesus Christ. Notice it says, from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And looking upon Jesus as he walked, I'm sorry, I skipped a step here, guys. Let's finish where we're. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. Again the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he saith, Behold the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. Then Jesus turned and saw them following, and saith unto them, What seek ye? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is to say, being interpreted, Master, where dwellest thou? Where are you staying? He saith unto them, Come and see. They came and saw where he dwelt, and abode with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon, and saith unto him, We have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted, the Christ. He brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, Thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Kepha, which is, by interpretation, a stone. The day following, Jesus would go forth into Galilee, and findeth Philip, and saith unto him, Follow me. Now Philip was at Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael, and saith unto him, and this part's really good, check this out, We have found him of whom Moses and the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, Can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? So figure like Nazareth's like a really... It's a really bad area. Imagine a town near where you live, which is like, let's say, the bad side of town or whatever, not a good area. And Nathanael said unto him, Can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Because they're saying that they found Jesus of Nazareth. He's the Messiah, basically. Or they're saying he's the one, we have found him of whom Moses and the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph, right? And Nathanael said, Can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip saith unto him, Come and see. Now, Nathanael must have been a really good guy, a really nice person, because watch what happens here. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and saith of him, so Jesus says this about Nathanael, Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. Nathanael said unto him, Whence knowest thou me? Jesus answered and said unto him, Before that Philip called thee, when thou wast under the fig tree, I saw thee. So what you have here is Nathanael's coming to meet Jesus because of what Philip said to him. And before he even gets up to Jesus, Jesus praises Nathanael and compliments him and says, "Behold, an Israelite in whom is no guile," you know, indeed. And Nathanael's like, "How does he know me?" You know, and then Jesus says, "I saw you when you were under the fig tree." And so Nathanael's like, "How could he know that?" Right? So Nathanael answered and said to him, unto him, "Rabbi, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said unto him, "Because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou? Thou shalt see greater things than these." And so it's pretty cool. Jesus, like, you know, you believe just because of that? Like, hey, you haven't seen anything yet. And he saith unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto you." Now, this phrase here, I know a lot of you guys that have watched the Bible studies, but this, I'm saying this for the new people. When Jesus says this, "Verily, verily," what he's really saying is this is true. This is 100% truth. You can rely on it. Like, in other words, look, I'm telling you the truth. This is going to happen. This is truth. This is objective truth. And he saith unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." John 2. "And the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother saith unto the servants, Whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. Jesus saith unto them, Fill the water pots with water, and they fill them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, Draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast, and they bear it. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was," like he doesn't know where it came from, "but the servant which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom." Now, I want to go through this with you a bit here, because when you first read this, I know when I was a new Christian and I read this, I was confused. I'm like, well, why is he saying this? And then, but then once you study it in the way they did it in that culture, I go, oh, I get it, and now I understand. Look what the governor of the feast says. He says, he calls the bridegroom and says, "Look, you know, every man at the beginning does set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now." Well, what does all that mean? Well, basically what would happen when they're celebrating, they would bring out the very good quality, expensive wine, right? But after the person's, you know, kind of getting a little bit tipsy and stuff, and they're not really, their taste buds aren't really tasting as much accurately, I should say, then they'll bring out the cheap stuff. So you get it? Is basically they bring out the really good stuff first, and after people are really into the celebration, they'll bring out the cheap old junk, you know, the low quality stuff. But notice, and he's basically saying, hey, you're doing it wrong. You but like the wine Jesus made was some very good quality wine. And he said unto him, every man at the beginning sets forth the good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. In other words, then you bring out the cheap stuff. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. So must have been some good tasting wine. This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. After this he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother, and his brethren, and his disciples, and they continued there not many days. And the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves, and the changers of money sitting. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple, and the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money, and overthrew the tables, and said unto them that sold doves, Take these things hence, make not my Father's house a house of merchandise. And his disciples remembered what was written, you know, in prophesied before Jesus even did that. The zeal of thine house hath eaten me up. So Jesus is very zealous of, you know, he's saying he's very zealous. Make not my Father's house a house of merchandise. And what happened is they would put these burdens on people, like, well, you've sinned, so you need to buy this and you need to sacrifice this. And they were basically turning it into a merchandising operation, making money off of people and stuff like that. Not that there's anything wrong with making money, but what's happening is that the overall message of the church wasn't to basically use these sacrifices and selling doves and stuff to turn it into like a merchandising operation. Now notice what Jesus does here. He drives them all out of the temple, the sheep and the oxen. He's basically letting all these animals go. He pours out the changer's money, you know, all these coins going all over the place, and he overthrew the tables, you know, and from that moment on, they start to get ticked off at him. I mean, he was very zealous, just like Scripture said, the zeal of thine house hath eaten me up. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, What sign showest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things? In other words, like, well, why are you doing this? You better give us a sign. Jesus answered and said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. And you guys know what he's talking about, himself. His body is the temple. Then said the Jews, 46 years was this temple in building. And they're thinking about the temple, you know, the material temple where people are in it, you know, the church, so to speak. They're saying, you know, give me a break. They're saying 46 years was this temple in building. It was, you know, took a long time. And you will build it again in 3 days? But he spoke of the temple of his body. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover and the feast day, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But Jesus did not commit himself unto them. I want you to see this. This is interesting. It says, but Jesus did not commit himself unto them because he knew all men. And he needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. You see that? So Jesus knew what was in their hearts. Notice he wouldn't commit himself to them because he knew all men. I mean, we actually do like a study on this. It's pretty eye-opening. Let's go to John 3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Now, let's stop a second here. Why is he going at night? You notice that? He was like a secret, you know, a secret follower, so to speak, of Jesus Christ. Like he cared what other people thought about him. See, he was intrigued with what Jesus' message was, and he was intrigued with Jesus, and he knew that Jesus was sent from God. He confesses it here. But at the same time, notice it says he comes to Jesus by night. Because, see, the Pharisees, the majority of them, were against Jesus. But he says to Jesus, we know that you're a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that you do except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, and there he is again, with the verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, would you say this is a very narrow statement that Jesus Christ said, or is it a very subjective, broad statement? Notice what he's saying. He's basically Jesus is putting this condition on man. He's saying, unless someone's born again, they're not going to see the kingdom of God. If that was true, then what would be our next rational thing to do? Figure out, well, what does this mean, born again? And it's interesting that that's what Nicodemus does. He follows the same rational thinking that you and I would. He asks them, how can a man be born when he is old? Now notice Nicodemus is thinking of the physical, the natural man, not the spiritual man. And Nicodemus says, can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, look, verily, verily. And he stresses it again. I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Now, I'm always getting asked this, and I'm going to tell you my opinion on what the scripture means, except a man be born of water and the Spirit. Okay? Because this, like, this passage right here, people will talk for months on this passage here, and they'll talk about should you be baptized, should you not be baptized, etc. And of course, I think we should all be baptized, but I don't believe that this is talking about water baptism here. Because look what it says in the whole passage. Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now look what Jesus says. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. So you know how when you're a child, you really basically are born of water. You're in your mother's womb, you know, in the water. You know how they go, their water breaks, and they talk about that. So notice it says, that which is born of flesh is flesh. Notice, except a man be born of water. So I put those two together. He's referring to this being born of water. And notice he says, and of the Spirit. And over here he says, and that which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. So let's read it all the way through. Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of Spirit is Spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. In other words, he's like, don't be surprised. This is important. You must be born again. Don't be so amazed that you don't pay attention. The wind bloweth where it is, where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. And you know that's true. You know how you see the wind blow, but you're not really seeing the wind, you're seeing debris in the wind. And you can kind of tell where the wind's at, like by the debris, but that's not really the wind that you're seeing. You're just seeing the debris of it. That's why Jesus says the wind blows where it wants, and you hear the sound, but you can't tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Now, Nicodemus answered and said unto him, how can these things be? Jesus answered and said unto him, art thou a master of Israel, and knowest not these things? Like, in other words, this is this guy's job. You know, he's a teacher of Israel, teaching the word of God to people. And Jesus is like, how could you not know this? You know, Jesus again, look, verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know, and testify that we have seen, and you receive not our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? That's a good point. You know, how could they believe in these awesome spiritual heavenly things if they can't even believe in earthly things that Jesus is telling them? And Jesus says, and no man has ascended up to heaven but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Notice Jesus is referring to his crucifixion that's going to be upcoming. That whosoever believeth in him, here it is, guys, should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son, check this out, not his Son into the world to condemn the world. Jesus isn't here to condemn us. We're already basically condemned because of our sins. So why is Jesus here then? He says because that the world through him might be saved. You see that? I think, and let's spend some time on this. We always talk about this a lot in our chat room. You guys should go below this video, shockofgod.net, go in the chat room, because there's always people in there talking about this. I think there's a misnomer, there's an error in society where people think they're not judged yet. And basically, one day, they may be judged or they won't be judged. But that's not what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying we're already all condemned. Look at it. This is what Scripture says. Jesus says, he that believeth on him is not condemned. You see that? John 3:18. But he that believeth not is, take a look at that with me. Let's spend about 20 seconds looking at that. He that believeth not is condemned already. Let that sink in. So if you're a Christian and you're preaching the gospel and someone says, well, you know, don't judge me. Say, well, I don't have any power to judge you, but you've already been judged. You're condemned already. We're like walking death. All that's left is the judgment, the day of judgment, the white throne judgment. So Jesus is saying, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. Isn't that past tense and present tense? Well, wait a minute. I thought all sins were forgiven, you know, Jesus Christ. Well, this is true if we put our hope, faith, and trust in Jesus Christ. But just because Jesus died and rose from the dead, it does mean that we could have worldwide salvation. There's no reason why the entire world could not be saved. But there are people that reject salvation. Look what Jesus says. Well, why are they condemned? Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Well, why? Why would they reject it? Well, look. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. And Jesus now says something that's totally politically incorrect, but so true. He says, for everyone that does evil hates the light. You ever meet someone that does a lot of evil and they just talk all good about Jesus Christ and praise him? No, they hate Jesus Christ. So notice it says, for everyone that does evil hates the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth come to the light, that his deeds may be manifest that they are wrought in God. After these things came Jesus and his disciples into the land of Judea, and he tarried with them and baptized. And John also was baptizing in Anon near to Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. Oh, and by the way, on the baptizing thing, you guys remember the thief on the cross? He didn't have time to go get baptized, and Jesus said, you know, truly I say to you, today you'll be with me in paradise, right? But we should get baptized, and I think it's a good thing, rather than debating about it. Should I, you know, is baptism essential for salvation? You know, out of love for God, we should get baptized. Everyone should. But let's go back to, now watch this. So John's baptizing, right? And it said, for John was not yet cast into prison. Because later on you read about it, historically, John gets thrown into prison. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoice greatly because of the bridegroom's voice, this is my joy, therefore is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease. So John's talking about Jesus Christ must increase, but I must decrease. And notice he says, he that cometh from above is above all. he's referring to Jesus Christ. This is clearly a reference to Jesus' divinity. He that is of the earth is earthly and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from the heaven is above all. And what he hath set to his seal, that God is true. Oh, sorry. And what he hath seen and heard, that he testifieth, and no man receiveth his testimony. He that hath received his testimony hath set to his seal that God is true. For he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God, for God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. The Father loveth the Son, and hath given all things into his hand. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not on the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Okay, John 4. When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, but, you know, Jesus' disciples that walked around with Jesus were baptizing. Jesus leaves Judea and departed again into Galilee, and he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, probably pronounced Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which I am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. So you catch this very beautiful conversation. Jesus asked her for a drink of water from the well, and she says, you know, how is it you're talking to me? I thought Jews aren't supposed to talk to, Samaritans and stuff. And Jesus then says, hey, look, if you knew who was talking to you, you would have asked me. Watch what he says here. If you knew the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou would have asked of him, and he would have given thee, here it is, living water. The woman saith unto him, and notice she's in her natural mind state. Jesus is obviously talking about this spiritual water. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, you know, no bucket or anything, no rope, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, Sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. So she's probably getting tired of going to the well, and she's like, probably like, well, whatever, you know, just where is the water then? Now, at this point, it takes a very unusual turn of events, and it there's a little bit of comedy to it, I would say. Watch this. Let me take a sip of my coffee real quick. My coffee's always hot when I start these Bible studies, and by the time I drink it, it's all like ice cold. Okay. So Jesus saith unto her, Go call thy husband and come hither. Now, don't you think that's kind of unusual that Jesus would say that? Unless you kind of knew what Jesus knew. Because watch. The woman answered and said, look what she says, I have no husband. Now, in a kind way, look what Jesus says. Doesn't this remind you what he just said earlier on? Remember with the gentleman that he saw underneath the fig tree? Remember? And the guy was like, well, how do you know me? Remember he said, behold, an Israelite in whom there is no guile. Remember how we just read that? Well, notice you see this going on here now, because watch what happens. She says, I have no husband. Jesus says, go call your husband. She says, I have no husband. Now, Jesus compliments her and says, thou hast well said, I have no husband. And then Jesus starts talking about her life. For thou have had, look how many husbands this woman had. She's like the Elizabeth Taylor of the Bible. Thou have had 5 husbands. And she's with the guy right now. Look, and he whom thou now has is not thy husband. So she's had 5 husbands, and she's got a boyfriend. And then Jesus, he basically compliments her, says, like, yep, you were telling the truth. Look, I'm telling you, it's got a little bit of comedy to it. You know, if you were a fly on the wall watching this conversation to see the woman's eyes, how she responds, right? So Jesus says, you know, and who you are with now is not your husband. So you basically told the truth. In that saidest thou truly. See, he's not being rude or anything. He's just basically pointing out, you know, that he knows. And the woman said unto him, sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship, you know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father, here it is, in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. And that's really interesting. Here's the next phrase. I was just about to talk about that, and Jesus talks about it here. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. And of course, Jesus is the Messiah. She doesn't know that yet. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Now, why would she say that? Well, Jesus is basically saying, look, notice he says, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. And Jesus says, you know, you worship what you don't even know. And he says, we know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Notice how Jesus is saying this. So the woman's basically, in my opinion, from reading it, she's kind of like, okay, to try to basically just keep the conversation where she feels better about it. Look what she says. She basically says, well, you know, I know the Messiah is coming, which is called Christ, and when he has come, he'll tell us all things. Like, you know, she's not really arguing with Jesus, but she's basically like, look, well, when the Messiah comes, he'll straighten things out. And, you know, so Jesus says unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. He's like, I am the Messiah. Now, the disciples, they get there and they see Jesus talking to a woman, right? And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, you know, like, why are you talking to her? What seekest thou? The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men, come see a man which told me all things that I ever did. Is not this the Christ? So she's like, I think this guy really is the Christ. Then they went out of the city and came unto him. In the meanwhile, his disciples prayed him, saying, Master, eat. But he said unto him, I have meat to eat that you know not of. Therefore said the disciples one to another, hath any man brought him out to eat? Like, Jesus, like, you know, I have food that I can continue going with. So the disciples think he's talking about, again, natural food. Jesus saith unto him, My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then come the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that saying true, one soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap that wherein you bestowed no labor. Other men labored, and ye are entered into their labors. And many of the Samaritans of the city. Now, this is not like a metaphorical story of this woman. This is a real historical event where the woman actually spreads the word about Jesus Christ. Look, and many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the woman, which testified, He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he would tarry with them, and he abode there 2 days. And many more believed because of his own word, and said unto the woman, Now we believe. So they go back to this woman, right? And they're like, hey, you know what? We believe not just because what you were saying, but we've heard him ourselves. Now we believe not because of thy saying, for we have heard him ourselves and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. Now, after 2 days, he departed thence and went into Galilee. For Jesus himself testified that a prophet hath no honor in his own country. Then when he was come into Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did at Jerusalem at the feast, for they also went into the feast. So Jesus came again into Cana of Galilee, where he made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. Then said Jesus unto him, Except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. The nobleman saith unto him, Sir, come down, ere my child die. Jesus saith unto him, Go thy way, thy son liveth. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, Thy son liveth. Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to amend. And they said unto him, Yesterday at the 7th hour the fever left him. So the father knew that it was at the same hour in which Jesus said unto him, Thy son liveth, and himself believed, and his whole house. This is again the second miracle that Jesus did when he was come out of Judea into Galilee. Let's go to John 5. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool. Oh, this is really interesting. And let me take a sip of my ice cold coffee. I don't really like coffee, but I like the coffee with the flavored cream. Okay, now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, or Bethesda, I apologize, having 5 porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. Now, this is interesting. People will always ask you, and I get the same thing, well, do you believe in angels and things like that? Well, I do, of course. And it obviously, we would all agree Jesus believed in angels. He spoke about them a lot. So I have no doubt angels exist, but check this out. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. So this is kind of an unusual thing that's happening here. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, wilt thou be made whole? So Jesus is asking him, do you want to be made whole? You know, do you want to be healed? The impotent man answered him, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. So every time the pool acts up, he goes to get in it, and he's never can get in there in time. Jesus saith unto him, rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, it is the Sabbath day, it is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. So here, they're basically throwing the baby out with the bathwater. You know, here Jesus heals the guy, and they're like, well, why are you carrying your, you know, they make a big deal about him carrying his mat, you know. He answered them, he that made me whole, the same said unto me, the guy says, well, you know, Jesus told me to take up my bed and walk. Then asked they him, what man is that? Like, who told you to do it, right? And he that was healed wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. So Jesus heals him, and the guy doesn't personally know Jesus Christ, so he can't really point out who he is. And there's such a giant multitude, Jesus is already in the crowd, it appears. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple. So Jesus finds the guy there that was healed, right? Interesting. And said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Now look what Jesus says here. This is interesting. Why would he say this? He says, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. Isn't that interesting? Wonder what this guy was into. Maybe he was into, like, pagan worship or something. Maybe he was into, I don't know, Jesus doesn't talk about it. But notice Jesus says, sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole, and now he knows who it is, right? And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. But Jesus answered them, my Father worketh hitherto, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. See that? The Jews knew what Jesus was claiming. I am awestruck how some people can read the Bible and say, well, Jesus never claimed that he was God. Jesus never confessed to be God. He never confessed to be the Messiah. What Bible are they reading? I think the people that say that, they haven't read it, but you can't say the Bible doesn't say it. It says it all throughout it. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, and look, he's referring to himself as the Son again. Again, Jesus says, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself but whatever he seeth the Father do. For whatever things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loves the Son, and sheweth him all things that himself doeth. And he will shew him greater works than these, that you may marvel. For as the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son. This is why earlier on, remember, it said those that believe in Jesus Christ are not condemned. Those that do not believe are condemned already. This is the key right here. All judgment unto the Son. That all men should honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son, honoreth not the Father which has sent him. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me has everlasting life, and he shall not come into condemnation. I was just talking about that, remember earlier, but is passed from death unto life. Verily, verily, again Jesus says, I say unto you, the hour is coming and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, they that have done good, here it is, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. I can of my own self do nothing as I hear. I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me. If I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. There is another that beareth witness of me, and I know that the witness which he witnesseth of me is true. Ye sent unto John, and he bare witness unto the truth. But I receive not testimony from man, but these things I say, look, that you might be saved. He was a burning and shining light, and you were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John. For the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do bear witness of me that the Father hath sent me. And the Father himself, which hath sent me, hath borne witness of me. You have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape. And you have not his word abiding in you, for whom he hath sent him, you believe not. Search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. And you will not come to me that you might have life. Look at that. And you will not come to me that you might have life. I mean, doesn't that just blow your mind? Why? I don't get it. I don't get it why people won't come to Jesus Christ if they can't have life. Let's continue. Jesus says, I receive not honor from men, but I know you that you have not the love of God in you. I am come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him you shall receive. Him you will receive. How can you believe which receive honor one of another, and seek not the honor that cometh from God only? Do not think, watch this, check this out. Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust. He says, for had you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if you believe not his writings, how shall you believe my words? Boy, Jesus is really laying the smack down there. He's preaching it. He's telling them truth. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. And a great multitude, now it's starting to get where there's now great multitudes following him. You see that? Why were they following him? Because they saw his miracles, which he did on them that were diseased. And Jesus went up into a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. And the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was nigh. When Jesus lifted up his eyes and saw a great company coming to him, he saith unto Philip. Now this is interesting. Why would he say, and this is another reason why I absolutely believe in the integrity of the Gospels, and I do believe the Gospels are true. If you actually research this, the more you research the Bible, the more you'll believe it's true. Why would he say to Philip, why would he talk to Philip about this? Watch this. When notice, where are they going? And it says, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Notice that. Jesus went up to a mountain, and notice, he comes to Philip, and Jesus says, "When shall we buy bread that these may eat?" And this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, and this is really epic when you actually read this, you know, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may take a little. Like, he's like, you know, there's no way we can feed all these people. Even if 200 penny worth, they can't even get a little. Why would Jesus ask Philip? Okay, I'm going to leave this as a mystery. Now, if you guys give up, email me and I'll tell you why. Why would Jesus ask Philip? Why wouldn't he ask Simon Peter? Why wouldn't he ask any of the other disciples? Why is Jesus asking Philip this question? There's a reason. I want to see if you guys can figure it out. When you actually realize it, you're like, it just adds even more integrity to the scriptures. Let's continue. I'll leave you in suspense. But if you email me, if you just can't take it, but try to figure it out yourself. Basically, here's the question that I have for you guys. See if you can get it. What's the question Jesus is asking? I'll give you a clue. When shall we buy bread that these may eat? And he's asking Philip that. Those are the two things. If you can connect those two things, why would he ask Philip is the question, okay? So let's see if you guys can do that. That's pretty difficult to figure out, but it took me a while. If you want to know the answer, email me on YouTube. I'll contact. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, saith unto him, "There is a lad here which has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but what are they among so many?" And Jesus said, "Make the men sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in number about 5,000. So picture this, 5,000 people there all sitting down. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were sat down, and likewise of the fishes as much as they would. When they were filled, he said unto his disciples, "Gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost." Therefore they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves which remained over and above unto them that had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the miracles that Jesus did, said, "This is of a truth that prophet that should come into the world. So now they believe, "This is of a truth that prophet should come into the world." When Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and take him by force to make him king, he departed again into a mountain himself alone. They're like, this is it. Let's usher in this new era. And because, you know, they wanted to escape this Roman rule. They wanted a king, right? So Jesus is perceiving they're going to get him. They're going to force him and try to make him king, right? So Jesus departs. And when even was now come, his disciples went down into the sea and entered into a ship. Excuse me. Now, so get this. Jesus, where were we at, guys? When Jesus perceived they were going to come by force and try to make him a king, Jesus leaves. But look, he's alone. Jesus leaves by himself. So all by himself, Jesus goes into a mountain himself, right? But then look, and when even was now come, his disciples go out to the sea. So you notice they're separated from each other. Maybe they can't find Jesus. Maybe they thought, well, maybe he went back on the other side, you know. So they enter into a ship and went over the sea toward Capernaum, and it was now dark. And Jesus was not come to them, so they can't find him, right? And the sea arose by reason of a great wind that blew. So they get into some rough seas here. So when they had rowed about 50 and 20 or 30 furlongs, they see Jesus walking on the sea and drawing nigh unto the ship, and they were afraid. So imagine you're on the sea and you see this figure coming towards you up out of the water. I'd be afraid too. I'd be terrified. But he saith unto them, it is I, be not afraid. Then they willingly received him into the ship, and immediately the ship was at the land whither they went. The day following, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other boat there, save that one whereunto his disciples were entered, and that Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that the disciples were gone away alone. So you see what they're doing is they're like, how did Jesus do that? Because they saw the disciples, believe me, they were looking for Jesus. Remember they wanted to what? Forcibly make him the king? So they see the disciples go on the boat, and Jesus is not with them. And then all of a sudden, Jesus is over there with them. They can't figure it out. So this is what it says here. The day following, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other boat there, save that one whereunto his disciples went. And there's like one boat that the disciples were in. They can't figure it out. Their minds can't grasp what happened. And that Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that his disciples were gone away alone. Howbeit there came other boats from Tiberias nigh unto the place where they did eat bread after that the Lord had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. Now you notice Jesus has this magnetic pull with the people, and they're just following him all around. And you know that's what would happen in the year 2012 and on if Jesus came back in the flesh. I'm telling you, you know darn well every single one of us would be following him around. See, Jesus didn't have that problem of getting people to listen to him and to follow him. His problem was, when you read scriptures, is, just getting some rest, physical rest. He's 100% God and 100% man. So here we go. When they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, when camest thou hither? Like, when'd you get here? Jesus answered them and said, Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat the loaves and were filled. So Jesus knows their hearts, they want like a free lunch and stuff. And Jesus like, look, I know you're looking because you, not because of the miracles and stuff, but because you had your bellies full. And Jesus says, look, don't labor for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth unto everlasting life. Which he's talking about the spiritual things he's telling him, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. My mom and dad bought me this really good book, and it's got different sayings of different famous preachers throughout history. And there was one saying in there, and it said, don't put your hope in things that you can see. If you can see it, it's not going to last. The things that last, the things that are eternal, are the unseen, the spiritual. Isn't that true? Then said they unto him, they talked to Jesus, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Now, isn't that an epic question? I know I use the word epic a lot when I'm reading the Bible, but it's just so epic. Isn't this the question of all questions? Assuming you want to get on God's side, you want to be on the winning team, and we want to please God and glorify him, this is the question right here. You guys want to know it? What shall we do that we might work the works of God? In other words, what does God want us to do? Now you're going to know the answer. Here it is. Jesus answers the question. Here we go. You on the edge of your seat, guys? What shall we do that we might work the works of God? You want to please God? Here it is. Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent. Doesn't seem too difficult, does it? God loves that we believe on him whom he has sent, Jesus Christ. They said therefore unto him, What sign showest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What dost thou work? In other words, like, okay, well, give us a sign, they're asking him. Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written, and that's true what they're saying. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said unto them, look what he says, there's the phrase again, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. Isn't that beautiful? Now, I want to show you something, like a little neat thing here. Let's go back here. Remember what happened here. It's like Jesus knew what they were going to say before they said it. Watch. You see right here where it says when the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, and then they come up to Jesus Christ and they ask him, they said, Rabbi, when camest thou hither? Remember that? They're like, hey, when'd you get here, you know? And Jesus knows their heart. Look what he says. Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but look, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Now, you might be thinking, why would Jesus, at first glance, you're like, that's kind of unusual that Jesus would start talking about this from this simple phrase here where they said, Rabbi, when camest thou hither? But when you read it all in its context, you're like, then you get why Jesus is saying that. He does know the hearts of men. Because look where the conversation goes. Jesus then says, Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. So notice, Jesus talks about spiritual things, and what are they? They're into the loaves. Remember, Jesus said, look, I know you're seeking me because of the loaves. You know, they want their bellies filled. Now look, you read on again. Remember, they say, well, what type of sign are you going to give me? And look what the people say again. They're still talking about this. Watch, he says, what sign showest thou then that we may see? And notice, he says, our fathers did eat manna in the desert, again with their bellies being full. You notice there's like a little trend here with these people. Look, they're telling Jesus, he gave them bread from heaven to eat, right? But now it makes sense. I'm like, that's why Jesus said that. He knew what they were going to say. He knew it. He even was talking about it up here before they even got to this point. He knew their hearts, right? It makes sense. So watch what Jesus says, because they said, well, you know, God gave us this manna from heaven, you know, this bread to eat, this food to eat, you know, from heaven. But watch what Jesus says. Well, what they're saying, by the way, and I want Jesus corrects them. They said, let me find it here. Okay, what sign? Okay, yeah, here it is. Notice they said, our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written. But and so Jesus is basically pointing out to them, look, Moses, Jesus says, look, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven. You see that? But my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. And obviously Jesus is referring to himself there. Then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you that you also have seen me and believe not. He senses that they don't believe, you know, Jesus knows they don't believe in him. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and he that cometh to me I will in no ways cast out. And what's awesome, if you've come to Jesus Christ, you know that you're salvation is secure. He's not going to cast you out. Everyone always says, Shock, do you believe once saved, always saved? I go, I do believe once saved, always saved if you don't walk away from Jesus Christ. But I do believe people can harden their hearts and walk away from Jesus Christ. But that's not what Jesus is talking about. He's saying, I will in no wise cast them out. But I know lots of people that have cast out Jesus Christ because of out of their life, like, you know, Oprah Winfrey and people like that. But that's not Jesus casting them out. That's Oprah, for example, casting Jesus out. People like that. So Jesus says, and it's a wonderful promise, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. So what is God's will for us? Well, we know Scripture says that God is not willing that any should perish. If you go to my main page on my YouTube channel, you go to shockforever.com and you look to the left, there's a passage there where it talks about what God wants for our lives. You know, he says, I know the thoughts that I think of you, thoughts of peace, to give you an unexpected end. You know, thoughts of peace, you know. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, Jesus said, that all of which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again the last day. So what's God's will for us? That we're raised up. And look, and this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life. That's God's will for us, that we may have everlasting life. I love God. I got no problem with God. God's my friend. He's my Lord. He's my Savior. He's everything to me. Thank God. Look, and I will raise him up at the last day. The Jews then murmured at him because he said, I am the bread which come down from heaven. And they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he saith, I come down from heaven? Jesus therefore answered and said unto them, murmur not among yourselves. No man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall be taught of God. Every man therefore that hath heard and hath learned of the Father cometh unto me. Not that any man hath seen the Father, save he which is of God, he hath seen the Father. There it is. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat man in the wilderness and are dead. Jesus basically saying it like it is. He said, this is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Now he's referring to his death on the cross. Now, notice when he's talking about bread and things like this, Jesus is not referring to natural. What's he talking about? The spiritual. But you notice there's like a trend. The people are talking about the natural. They're talking about filling their bellies with the... Remember Jesus said, I know what you're looking for, because you had your fill of the bread and the fish. Okay. So what Jesus is saying, he's showing them that he is the bread that come down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. So they don't get it. They're still thinking in the natural. I get it. He's referring to the spiritual, the bread of life. You know, you've heard the song, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. And this is what Jesus is trying to convey to them. The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give his flesh to eat? See, they don't get it. Then Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. These things said he in the synagogue, as he taught in Capernaum. Many therefore his disciples, when they heard this, they said, This is a hard saying. Who can hear it? See, they don't get it. They don't get it yet, what Jesus is saying. When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, Doth this offend you? What and if you shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh, look, profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, look, they are spirit and they are life. See, these people aren't getting it. They're thinking fleshly, they're thinking natural, the natural world. And Jesus is like, look, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak to you, they're spirit. They are life. But there are some of you, Jesus says, that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. And he said, Therefore said I unto you that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. Now look what happens here. From that time many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then Jesus said unto the 12, Will you also go away? Then Simon Peter says these epic, yes, epic words. Then Simon Peter answered him, and I think we'll stop this part of the video here because it's really good way to do this first part of the video. Jesus asked them, Will you also go away? Because these other disciples are leaving. Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered them, Have not I chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil? He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. Now, we just read John all the way up to John 6. John 6:71. So we'll continue in John later on. Don't forget to click right below this video. Go to shockofgod.net and click where it says entire Bible on audio. If you'd like to hear the rest of this, you could listen to that. But let's talk about this part where Jesus is saying, his flesh is meat indeed, and his blood is drink indeed. What would happen in the Old Testament when you would sin? You would get like a lamb, for example, and you would sacrifice the lamb, and part of the meat of the lamb could go towards the priest, you know, and they could even eat some of the lamb. I've read some parts where they're allowed to have some of it. But what you would do is they would sacrifice this lamb, and you would put your hand on the lamb's head, I believe, if I remember correctly. And this was like a spiritual transfer of your sin, because the penalty for sin is death. So this was like a covering of your sin. But what would happen is people would constantly be doing these animal sacrifices as a covering of their sin. And all that really was is a shadow of Jesus Christ coming to the earth. So when Jesus Christ comes to the earth, he basically says no more animal sacrifice. This is why they refer to Jesus as I am the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. So when Jesus is talking about this, what he's basically showing them is what's going to happen. And when you read about Jesus at the Last Supper, where he says he gets the bread, He doesn't get his body and do it right there. He gets the bread and he breaks it, and he says, take this and eat. This is my body. And it's a new covenant that he makes with mankind. And then he gets the wine and he says that this is his blood. And it's a spiritual ceremony, so to speak. It's a spiritual thing that you can do, communion, and you basically honor God with this. And this is where, remember, Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. And if someone's ill, or if you're kind of struggling with certain things, I think some of the best thing that you can do is actually get into the scripture and actually read it. It's not natural food, it's spiritual food. And it's like the water at the well that Jesus was talking about. Because if you are thirsty in life, if you're thirsty in life, and you drink of this water that Jesus Christ is telling you, you'll never be thirsty again. So I appreciate you guys coming to the smorgasbord here, where we give you spiritual food. And I love you guys. God bless you. Have a great week. Don't forget, go right below to shockonl.net and click where it says entire Bible on audio. And I have to tell you, I've got some really good preachings that I've heard of, and I'll get the best ones, the ones that really empower you as a Christian. If you go to the same website below this video and click Music Podcast, there's some really good ones there that you should listen to. I think you'd really enjoy them. Have a great week. Thanks for listening.